what we derived in the last class was the concentration of electrons, in the conduction band. Okay, we denote it as N0, and we obtained a relationship which is Nc into e raised to minus of Ec minus Ef by kVt. And similarly, we obtained another relationship, which is the concentration of holes in the valence band. We denoted it as P0, and then we got it as Nv into e raised to minus of Ef minus Ev by kVt. So these are the two relationships that we derived in the last class. Okay, so where Nc is given as 2 into 2 pi m star of electron kT 3 by 2 divided by h cube. That was Nc. And similarly, Nv is 2 into 2 pi m star of holes, effective mass of holes into kBt. So let me put kBt raised to 3 by 2 divided by h cube. Okay, so this is Nc and Nv. Okay, so they are called Nc and Nv are called the effective density of states. Conduction band and valence band respectively, which means that as if this much states are available, and when you multiply the number of states available with the probability density function for electron to be occupying that state, we will get basically the electron number. And similarly, you can interpret P0 as a multiplication of effective density of states in the valence band multiplying with the probability of non-occupancy, okay, which is probability for the state to be vacant, which is 1 minus f of v. So that you can interpret in that way, we get this as the effective density of states. Now, one interesting observation is that this number of electron and holes are equal for intrinsic semiconductor. Okay, we are basically, I said that we are looking at intrinsic semiconductor, but if it is an intrinsic semiconductor, N0 should be equal to P0. For intrinsic semiconductor, N0 should be equal to P0. Intrinsic semiconductor, N0 should be equal to P0. So that is Nc N0 should be equal to P0. Why? Because whatever in electron that are there in the conduction band, they must have come from the valence band by thermal excitation. Okay, so if you look at the energy band diagram of the semiconductor, so it is something like, I am just showing the bottom of the valence band and top of the conduction band. Okay, so if at all there is any holes here, correspondingly there is an electron in the correspondingly there is an electron here. Okay, they should be equal. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 holes are there. So then we should have 8 electrons in the conduction band. Okay, so this is the conduction band. Bottom of the conduction band we have electrons, and top of the valence band we have holes. And they should be equal. So that is what we are saying. Okay. Now, since the expression for N0 and P0, one of them has EC minus EF with a minus sign, and the other one has EF minus EV. So that means if you look at the sign of EF in the first expression for N0, it is positive, and the sign of EF in the second expression is negative. Okay, so if I multiply N0 with P0, okay, so let me call this as equation 1 and 2, equation 1 and equation 2, multiplying equation 1 and 2, equation 1 and 2, that is N0 into P0, N0 into P0, so that will give you, first of all you have NC into e raised to minus of EC minus EF, so here the sign of EF is positive. And then P0, which was NV into e raised to minus of EF minus EV. So here the sign of EF is negative. So by multiplying these together, we will be able to cancel EF in this RHS. Okay. So let me write N0, and since P0 they are equal for intrinsic semiconductor, I will call it as Ni. Okay, Ni is the concentration of intrinsic semiconductor, and since Ni equal to Pi, okay, so they are the concentration for intrinsic semiconductor where there is no other impurity added to it. So this is equal to, that is Ni square. Because they are equal, I can write like this, NC into NV into, now if you look at all the remaining terms, I have minus EC here and then minus EV, okay, EV has plus sign and then divide by KBT. Now this is EC minus EV is a familiar quantity, okay, so this is this one, which we call as EG. So therefore, you can write Ni square as NC into NV into e raised to minus EG by KBT. Okay. So that looks very interesting relationship. Why? Because you don't have any Fermi level here, and you have energy band gap, which is a constant of the material, okay, for silicon energy band gap is 1.1 electron volt, and for say gallium arsenide it is something like 1.45 electron volt. So depending upon the different material, and gallium arsenide, for germanium you have even smaller energy band gap. And therefore, this is just a material property, EG is a material property, and then similarly, NC and NV, that expression, if you look at, that contain basically effective mass and some constants, right? Temperature is there, of course, and then other than temperature, there is effective mass, which is a material property. So what I mean to say is that this expression contains only material property, and material property are Eg, energy gap, and m star, which is the effective mass, and then temperature. So therefore, what we can say is that for intrinsic semiconductor, the concentration of carriers, it could be electrons in the valence band, Ni, depends, or it could be holes in the valence band. So it depends only on the material, whether it is silicon, germanium, gallium arsenide, material properties, and specifically material properties Eg and m star. Okay, m star for electron, m star E, then m star H for holes. So these are the two things that it depends upon. It depends only on the material property Eg and effective mass. For intrinsic semiconductor, the concentration of carriers depends only on the material property Eg and Eg, and also and the temperature, which is the variable. Okay, temperature absolute degree Kelvin, temperature in absolute degree Kelvin, which is 300 degree Kelvin for so that means as you vary the temperature, you can see that this intrinsic concentration varies. Okay, or you can say Ni is equal to square root of Nc into Nb into e raised to minus Eg by kVt. So that is so this is the same concentration for electrons as well as holes. It only depend upon Eg, the material property, and m star, which is the effective mass of electrons and holes, and then the temperature. Okay, so as you increase the temperature, so let's do a problem to see how it changes. So this is a problem I am taking from the book. So question is, calculate Ni of gallium arsenide at temperature equal to 300 degree Kelvin and at 450 degree Kelvin. Okay, so two temperature is given, and at two temperature we need to calculate the value of Ni. given for gallium arsenide, Nc at room temperature, Nc at room temperature, okay, Nc at T, because Nc also depends upon temperature. So at 300 degree Kelvin, it is given as 4.7 into 10 raised to 70 per centimeter cube, and Nb at the same temperature, 300 degree Kelvin, it is given as 7 into 10 raised to 18 per centimeter cube. So these are the number of states, Nb and Nc, at room temperature. As temperature increases, we know that it is proportional to 3 by 2, T raised to 3 by 2. So it will definitely increase. As temperature increases beyond 300, Nc and Nb will also increase. Okay, so question is, find out Ni at this temperature. So first let us find it out for 300 degree Kelvin. So Ni at T equal to 300 degree Kelvin. So what do you need to do? So let us find out Ni square, which is Nc into Nb. Nc is given as 4.7 into 10 raised to 17 per centimeter cube. Nb is given as 7 into 10 raised to 18 per centimeter cube. Now one thing you can notice is that NV is greater than NC. They are not same. For this gallium arsenide, NV is 7 into 10 raised to 18. It's almost more than 10 times. More than 10 times. It may be something like 20 times. Okay, nearly 20 times, okay, 15 to 20 times more NV. So that means the effective mass is the quantity that differs. So in the expression for NC and NV, effective mass is there. So that is different for conduction band and valence band. So in this particular material, for conduction band, the effective mass is smaller compared to that of the valence band. So if you look at the expression, so this is the expression. So there is effective mass raised to 3 by 2 of electron in NC, and for holes MH star raised to 3 by 2. So MH star is greater than ME star. So that is why we have a different value for NC, and or you can say NB is more than 15 times greater than NC. So that much times effective mass is also is varying. Okay, so this then multiplying e raised to, okay, so when I take the square root, I have to put one, so here there should be a 2. If I am taking ni, I should take a square root of this exponential, so which is like dividing the exponent by 2. So I missed that earlier. Okay, but I am finding out ni square, so it is e raised to. So I need to know the energy band gap. So energy band gap is also given. Eg is also given as 1.42 electron volt. So let me put this here. E raised to minus 1.42 divided by and the value of KT at room temperature or 300 degree Kelvin is 0.0259 electron volt. So this is what I want to calculate, and if you evaluate this, you will get it as 5.09 into 10 raised to 12 per centimeter raised to 6, because there is centimeter cube multiplying centimeter cube, so you will get square of centimeter cube, which is centimeter raised to 6. So square root of this is going to be the value of Ni. So therefore Ni is equal to 2.26 into 10 raised to 6 per centimeter cube. Okay, which is quite less compared to silicon. It is less because the energy band gap is very large. Okay, so the material and also effective mass is also something that will affect it. Okay, so now what about the other temperature, which is T equal to 300 degree Kelvin. Okay, so this is number part one. Part two is T equal to 450. Now NC into NV is going to change now. Okay, how are they going to change? It is proportional to T raised to 3 by 2. So the way we can consider for that T equal to 450 degree Kelvin, if we do this calculation, so Ni square is equal to, so what was given NC is 4.7 into 10 raised to 17 per centimeter cube. So this is basically for T equal to 300 degree Kelvin. When you evaluate this, you will use 300 raised to 3 by 2 in the expression for NC. So NC at 300 degree Kelvin is proportional to this. But NC at 400 degree Kelvin it will be proportional, or 450 degree Kelvin, it will be proportional to 450 raised to 3 by 2. Okay, so that is, so how we can correct it? So we can multiply this thing with, so divide by 300 and multiply by 450 into 3 by 2. So that way I can get what is the NC. That will give you the NC at T equal to 450 degree Kelvin. Similarly, I have to do for NV also. So what is NV? NV is basically 7 into 10 raised to 18 per centimeter cube. And then now I divide by 300, multiply by 450 raised to 3 by 2. So that I can get an expression proportional to 450 raised to 3 by 2. Okay, so that way I that way I can modify into e raised to minus 1.42 electron volt divided by whatever is the KBT of 450. So that I need to find out. So KBT T equal to 450 degree Kelvin is equal to 1.38 into 10 raised to minus 23. If I want it in electron volt, I need to divide this 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19, and T is 450. So if you do this, what you are going to get is basically 0.03885. So that I substitute 0.03885. Okay, so that is going to be equal to 1.48 into 10 raised to 21 per centimeter raised to 6. So therefore Ni at T equal to 450 degree Kelvin, which is the square root of this Ni square, and we will get it as 3.85 into 10 raised to 10 per centimeter cube. So you see that earlier we had 10 raised to 6 at 300 degree Kelvin, okay, at 300 degree Kelvin we had a 2.2 into 10 raised to 6, and it has now increased to 10 raised to 10. Okay, so when you increase the temperature by 150 degree Celsius, okay, the 150 degree Celsius increment is same as in Kelvin also by 150 degree. So that means from room temperature you add 150 degree Celsius, then the carrier concentration, the intrinsic carrier concentration is changing by 4 orders of magnitude. Okay, 4 orders of magnitude, that is multiplying by 10 raised to 4, okay, or 10,000. So that is a strong function, okay. Just by increasing 150 degree Celsius, we are able to change the intrinsic carrier concentration by 4 orders of magnitude. Therefore, we can say that Ni is a strong function. Therefore, Ni is a, because there is a strong dependency, strong function of temperature. Okay. Now let's look at the problem of locating the Fermi level position for intrinsic semiconduction. So let me Fermi level position for intrinsic semiconductor. Fermi level position for intrinsic semiconductor. Okay, so how we can find out this? So we already established that the intrinsic carrier concentration is independent of the location of the Fermi level. But now if you want the location of the Fermi level, now we can find out. So again, for intrinsic semiconductor, we know that Ni is equal to Pi. So now I am going to substitute the relationship for, I mean, expression for Ni is e raised to minus of Nc into e raised to minus Ec minus Ef by kBT. It is easy to remember it because Nc is a big quantity, okay, of the order of 10 raised to 18, 10 raised to 19, like that. And you are multiplying with a quantity which is going to be less than 1. Okay. And if it this has to be less than 1, you have to write it as a negative exponential of a positive number. Okay, Ec minus Ef is positive because Fermi level lies between Ec and Ef most of the case. So Ec minus Ef is positive. So negative of that will be F number at the exponent will give you something which is going to be much lesser than 1, so that when you multiply with Nc, you will get a quantity which is going to be lesser than Nc. So that way you can remember this expression. Similarly, Pi, you can write it as Nv. Nv is also something like 10 raised to 18. And here Ef is greater than Ev. Okay, Ec is greater than Ef, but Ef is greater than Ev. So if you have to write it as a negative exponent, you have to write it as minus Ef minus Ev. So this way you can remember this expression. So I have written the expression for Ni, which we derived in the last class, and also for Pi, we derived in the last class. And I, since it is an intrinsic material, so this is only true for intrinsic material. So we are studying about intrinsic semiconductor. Okay. So now what we can do, so with this you can rearrange like this. You take the exponentials on one side and Nc to the other side. So you can write it as Ec minus Ef by kBT, then plus Ef minus Ev by kBT. So when you take it to the other side, it will become plus. Then this is equal to Nv by Nc. Okay. So that is, now if you look at the exponent, you can see that this can be written as minus of Ec plus Ev by kBT, and then you have plus 2Ef by kBT. Okay, so this exponent can be written like it because Ef is positive on both term. So you can write it as 2Ef by kBT is equal to Nv by Nc. Okay, so now I'm going to take a natural logarithm on both sides, that is 2Ef by kBT plus Ec, sorry, minus, this should be minus, minus of Ec plus, minus of Ec plus Ev by kBT is equal to natural logarithm of Nv by Nc. So let me continue to write here. Okay, so therefore 2Ef, we want to know where is this Ef located. 2Ef minus Ec plus Ev is equal to kBT ln of Nv by Nc. Or Now if you rearrange, you can find out EF. EF is what? If you take EC plus EV to the other side, so that divide by 2 plus KBT by 2 ln NB by NC. Now EC plus EV by 2 is basically the center. So this one is basically the center of energy band gap. Center of, but it is, you see that EF is not exactly at the center, it is shifted by some amount, and that is related as KBT by 2 ln NB by NC. Now NB NC has a lot of constants and effective mass raised to 3 by 2. So if you substitute that, so you can write it as EC plus EB by 2 plus, so there will be effective mass of hole divided by effective mass of electron hole raised to 3 by 2 after subtract. All the rest will be cancelled because they are like constants, like Planck's constant, 2 pi raised to 3 by 2, 2, okay, this will be cancelled, and only thing that will be, and temperature will also get cancelled because same temperature. So only thing that will be left is mh by mh star by me star the whole raised to 3 by 2, and then logarithm of a raised to b is b a raised to, so that if I apply, I will get it will be 3 by 2 coming here, and so it will become 3 by 4 kbt mh star by me star. So what does it say? So if the hole has higher effective mass than electron, then the Fermi level of the intrinsic material, so since this we are talking about Fermi level of the intrinsic material, let us denote it as EF with I, so which means that it is the intrinsic Fermi level. So everywhere let me introduce EFI. So EFI. So we are finding out EFI, Fermi level of the intrinsic material. So that will be given like this. So Fermi level of the intrinsic material is what we found out. It is not exactly, if it has to be exactly at the middle of conduction band and valence band, then the condition is that both the valence band and conduction band should have same effective mass. Okay. Which is not usually the case, even most of the material, the effective mass of the valence band is more than that of the conduction band. Okay, so therefore NC or NB is larger usually than NC, and therefore the Fermi level is more closer to the conduction band than to the valence band, but it is almost at the center. That the variation from the middle is very negligible, so because the effective mass they don't vary so much, and it is proportional to the logarithm, so that will suppress the dependency to a lower level. Okay, so that is about intrinsic semiconductor. Now let's go to extrinsic semiconductor. Extrinsic semiconductor. So extrinsic semiconductors, what are they? So they are they are basically doped semiconductor. They are basically doped semiconductor. So they are of two types. Either we dope it with n-type material. If doped with n-type material, If doped with n-type material, then we call it as n-type impurity. Okay, not material, n-type impurity. I'll tell you what is n-type impurity. So we call it as n-type semiconductor. Similarly, if doped with p-type impurity, then we call it as n-type impurity can also be called as donor impurity. P-type impurity can also be called as acceptor impurity. Then we call it as, so if you are doping it with acceptor impurity, we get a p-type semiconductor. So they are of two types. Now in our discussion, the formula that we derived, that is number of electrons in conduction band, that is N0, in that that formula should should also apply for this formula, that is NC into e raised to EC minus EF by KVT. It should be useful for n-type and p-type semiconductor provider under certain condition, and the condition is like the approximation of Fermi-Dirac distribution should be valid in the derivation. Okay, under those condition, so similarly number of holes in valence band P0, that is NV into e raised to EF minus KV by KT. So this should be valid, if the approximation of FD distribution, is good. Okay. So for intrinsic, we know that it is very good. But what about extrinsic semiconductor? So let's see what happens in extrinsic semiconductor. In extrinsic semiconductor, N0 and P0 are not going to be same. Now, what can be the reason why N0 and P0 are not going to be the same? The reason for that is that EF is not going to be, or EC minus EF is not same as EF minus EV. In other words, they are not nearly at the middle of the energy gap. It is either shifted upward or shifted downward. Okay. So Fermi level for an n-type is going to be shifted upward from the mean position, and similarly from the intrinsic level it is going to be shifted downward for the p-type semiconductor. So let me draw this and show the intrinsic, the extrinsic, etc. So if this is the energy, and let me draw the okay, so this is our EC, and then we have some EG band gap. So and this is our EV. So this is our EG. Okay, so this is what, this is our density of states. So So we are drawing density of states. Density of states with respect to energy, how the density of states varies. Okay, so it is proportional to that square root of E minus EC, etc. So that is the plot. Now, then I said if you want to find out the number density, then you also have to draw the Fermi Dirac distribution function. Okay, so for N type, if I draw, so let me show you the somewhere at the middle we have EFI, which we found out it will be almost at the middle, maybe a little more above than the middle. So that if it is there, then I draw the Fermi Dirac function, it will be half exactly at that point, and then one very much below it. Okay, it will be one here, half at the intrinsic Fermi level. So this is where. Okay, so this is for intrinsic, but now I am going to interested in drawing the Fermi level for n-type. So n-type, what I will do is like, I'll go like halfway between EFI and EC upward, and it will become clear why I take that point. Okay, so the half point will be somewhere here. So this is the half point and this is the zero point. So if I smoothly, join this, like this. This is our central point where a Fermi Dirac distribution is half. Now, if I look at the product of density of states and this F of E, that will give us an idea of electrons and holes. So let me draw another diagram to show the N of E. So here I am going to draw N of E. So N of E is basically determined by so you can see that there is a large overlap here where it is both non-zero. So you see it will be something like this. Okay, large overlap, and then here if you look at so this is what, this is N of E, which we earlier defined as D. So this is our DC of E, and this is DV of E. So N of E is basically DC of E multiplying F of E. Okay, that is N of E. And similarly, if you look at here, this overlap between 1 minus F of E and DV of E. So I'll write it. It is going to be much smaller. So this is P of E. P of E is what? DV of E into 1 minus F of E. So the red is f of e. So 1 minus, if I draw 1 minus, then it is almost 0 here, and then it will be like this. So this is 1 minus f of e. So I am multiplying the orange, this one, 1 minus f of e with the dv of e. Okay, dv of e. So here I am multiplying dc of e with the f of e. So this I have drawn in red, so let me draw it. So this is, so dc of e, which is this, multiplying with f of e, there is a large overlap here where both are non-zero, so there we get a large product. Whereas if you look at here, the only place where you have overlap is very negligible. Because why? This is shifted, this new EF position is here. This is our new EF position. Earlier it was in the middle, so we have shifted it upward, and that is how we achieved. So integral of this is going to give us integral of n of e dE is going to give us n0, and integral of p of e dE is going to give us P0. Okay, so this is the way things are going to look like. There is an asymmetry now. The number of electrons are going to be very large. Now, so this is n-type semiconductor scenario. From a occupation of the energy state point of view is concerned. Okay, so this is n-type semiconductor. So n-type semiconductor has n0 much greater than p0. So that is what we call as n-type semiconductor, and that is achieved because you see the area of this curve is going to be much larger compared to the area of p of e curve. Okay, so that is achieved by shifting just EF upward. Now the opposite scenario, if you look at, we can shift it in the opposite direction, say so again this is the EC, EB, and then middle point is EFI approximately. Now my EF is going to be somewhere here. EFI means intrinsic. So now I have shifted it downward. This is the point where I will have half. Okay. So this point I have half. This point I have one. If I now draw the Fermi-Dirac distribution, then like this, and toward the upward direction, if you look at. So this is the Fermi-Dirac distribution f of e, and 1 minus f of e, if I draw again, it will pass through this point. ओके So one thing is clear, the area of overlap here is going to be much larger compared to the area of overlap it is here, it is very negligible. So just like earlier way, we can draw. The N0 and P0 or P of E and N of E. N of E, P of E. So now what will happen here, when you look at P of E, it is going to be a big function because the overlap is more, where you have DC of E overlapping with 1 minus F of E. So this is 1 minus F of E, you multiply that with this one, which is dv of E, that product is what we call as P of E. So that product is going to be a huge function. So the area under this is what is going to give you. And similarly, if you do that for a conduction band, you see that it is going to be very negligible. So this is our N of E. And this is our P of E. So for P type semiconductor, the vacancies are going to be much larger. The reason is that we have shifted the Fermi level or Fermi function, Fermi Dirac function downward by shifting our EF downward. The earlier case we shifted it upward, now we have shifted it downward. So look at this. This is our earlier okay, whereas the current EF is somewhere here. So we are shifted and the middle point is where is you have this one, this middle point is EF. So these two area will be equal for intrinsic semiconductor, but if you are shifting EF upward, the entire Fermi Dirac function shift upward. If you are shifting it downward, the entire EF Fermi Dirac, when EF is shifted downward, entire Fermi Dirac function is shifted downward, making number of holes larger than number of. So here this is basically called P-type semiconductor. Okay, so you can see that M0 is much, which is the area of this curve, it is much lesser than this. So this is the way we can think about N-type semiconductor and P-type semiconductor. Now, physically, how does this come about? Okay, we would like to understand how, I am saying that it will be shifted upward, but how does it shift upward, or how can we say that N0 is much larger than P0 for N-type semiconductor, and for P-type semiconductor P0 is much larger than N0? How can we say that? Okay, so simple way we can talk about this is so we have a silicon lattice where you have silicon atom sitting in a, so I am representing it like a 2D. So in one of the silicon lattice point we have say arsenic atom sitting and everything else is still silicon. And we know that the nearest neighbor for all silicon atom is 4. It will have 4 nearest neighbors. They are into all the corners of tetrahedron, this we have seen earlier in an earlier class. Okay, so we have covalent bond with the 4 nearest neighbor atom. So every silicon atom usually do that covalent bonding. Now if you replace silicon atom with arsenic atom, what will happen is that arsenic has 5 electrons in the outer shell, out of which 4 will enter into covalent bond, and one of the electron will be not participating in bond. Okay, it is loosely attached to the arsenic atom. Okay, there is a binding force, but that force of binding is very less. So if you look at from an energy band structure point of view, what is going to happen is that so here I am going to draw what is called as a band diagram, not band structure. I am going to draw what is called as band diagram. So band diagram is a different way of drawing band structure, where we only show the variation of the bottom of the conduction band and top of the valence band, and how it varies with respect to position. So here now this is some x direction of the material. So if you look at x direction, and EC is like this, and the top of the conduction band is somewhere here, and then similarly you have valence band bottom somewhere here, and this is our EG. So inside EG, for intrinsic material, you don't have any. So these are all full of different energy states. Okay. So here K information is not there, only X direction we are taking. Okay. This is called band diagram. The other one is called band structure. Now we will stop looking at band structure, because we don't need that details anymore. That was only needed till we evaluate the density of states, etc. Once we evaluate the density of states, then EK diagram, which is called band structure. So EK diagram is called band structure. That is called band. This has more details, from which we can find out many things. We already found out many things like effective mass, EC, EV, and then density of states. All of this were found out from the band structure. So we no longer require that anymore. We will make use of the things that we found out. And then in order to study devices, mostly we make use of band diagram, which is basically a plot of energy bands with respect to position coordinate. Okay, so this is with respect to moment and coordinate. Band structure is with respect to energy versus momentum. Okay, crystal momentum. K is crystal momentum. Whereas band diagram, we do the drawing of energy level or energy bands with the position coordinate. Now, the act of introducing a impurity atom is like creating one level just inside the energy band gap. Earlier there was no level, but now we have introduced some level. For each impurity atom, there will be one state that is getting created, and that state is basically the state in which the loosely bound electron attached to the donor atom. So this is the donor atom. Here we have the donor atom. This donor atom has an extra electron that is free to move with a large radius. Okay, around the donor atom it is free to move. It is still attracted by its positive nucleus, but very weakly attracted. Okay, because the weak attraction, the corresponding state, if you want to put in a band diagram, we have to put just underneath the so these are new levels that are created because of the addition of this doped atom, okay, the donor impurity atom. And they are not forming any band, because this arsenic atom, if one is here, the other arsenic atom may be like far apart, okay, maybe like after 100 nanometer or something like that. They are not like closely spaced like the silicon atom. So all the nearest neighbors of the arsenic atom will be silicon atoms, and the next arsenic atom is far apart. So the potential due to this arsenic atom, which is where acting upon this loosely bound electron will not in general interact with the next arsenic atom which is on the x direction. That may be far apart. So that is why I am showing it like a dashed line. Okay, so this is one arsenic atom, then next arsenic atom is little far away. So this I told you already, x direction is basically x axis, which is a position coordinate. So it is like far away, far away, far away. So they are not interacting. If they become like very, very heavily doped, then this arsenic atom may come somewhat nearby and they begin to interact, in which case this will become a band in itself. Just like silicon bands were created, we will have arsenic atom interacting with each other. The impurity banding will also happen. But we are considering a case where the concentration of the impurity atom is such that they are far apart and they don't interact. So there is an electron sitting in each of this state. One electron is actually sitting at. So this is the picture at say t equal to T equal to 0 degree. Then what happens is that as you increase the temperature from 0 degree Kelvin to some larger temperature, let's say this is a 0 degree, so I am showing with the same color. One electron, every state is occupied with this loosely bound electron. So now I am increasing to say 300 degree Kelvin. So 300 degree Kelvin is a much larger energy. You can calculate how much is the difference, but I am not going into that details. So this difference is of the order of 0.05 electron volt for silicon, and for other materials it may be even less, smaller than that, like 0.01. Okay, so I am just putting a range, 0.01. 0.05 to 0.01 electron volt. 0.01 electron volt to 0.05 electron volt. So that will be like very, very negligible. Our energy band Eg is like 1.1 electron volt for silicon, and it is 1.42 electron volt for gallium arsenide, etc. So that is much, much larger compared to this. So at 300 degrees Kelvin, what will happen? All this electron will go to the above conduction band. They will occupy this conduction band. And when they occupy the conduction band, what will happen? Some of them will, try to recombine with these electrons or the vacancies in the valence band. So two things are happening. One is like this extra electron, they gain energy and go up, or they may relax by going down into the vacancies inside the. So there could be holes here. Okay, so the holes will get filled up with electrons. They will get filled up. So there will be no more holes because of the relaxation they will be lost by recombination. So these two things are happening. One is like a reduction of holes in the valence band, because this loosely bound electron can go to the valence band, or increase of electrons in the conduction band. So in n-type semiconductor, what happens is that the N0 will go up because the why N0 goes up? Because electron from the impurity level, this is also called as donor level. So because the electrons which are loosely bound electrons from the donor level, well, easily go to the they will go the N0 will go up because the electrons from the donor easily get excited into the conduction band. Similarly, some of them fall or relax. The opposite of excitation is relaxation. Similarly, some of them relax and fall into the valence band. So what does that mean? So therefore, what will happen if they fall into valence band? The electron hole pair recombination will happen, resulting in electron hole pair recombination. Resulting in electron hole pair recombination and reduction of P0. So whenever hole is recombined with those electrons which came from the donor impurity level, the number of holes will go down, whereas the number of electrons will go up because we are getting additional electrons into the conduction band from the impurity level. Both are coming from the impurity level. So from the impurity level, electrons are coming to the conduction band, increasing N0, and from the impurity level, electrons are falling back into the valence band, destroying the holes. So P0 reduces. So that is the physical reason we can give why N0 is more for N-type impurity compared to P0, or N0 is called the majority carriers. N0 is called the majority carriers, and P0 is called the minority carriers. Now, same picture, similar picture you can talk about in the case of a P-type semiconductor. So let's look at now P-type semiconductor. So what is happening in P-type semiconductor? So again, you can draw what is called the band diagram. So this is your EC and EV. So this is your band, and you have another band like this. This is called the conduction band. This is your conduction band, and this is your valence band. Top of the conduction band is what we call as EV. Bottom of the conduction band is what we call as EC, and they are separated by EG, just like before. Now what we are doing, we are adding a boron atom. So there is silicon all around like this. Okay. Now silicon used to make 4 bonds, but boron don't have four electrons in the outermost shell, so they cannot make 4 bond. So there is one lack here. Okay, so this here there is a lack. So let me show that lack here. So this, there is a lack here, lack of one electron, because boron don't have the fourth electron. It has only 3 electrons. So now into this lack, it can accept from nearby silicon bond. Okay, so that it can do. So what does that mean in from the band structure diagram? It means that we are going to have there is going to be some levels just above the so this is how acceptor levels are getting created. This is called acceptor impurity level. In acceptor impurity level, it can accept electrons from the electrons in the valence band, because the difference is again of the order of this difference in these energies are also like 0.1 electron volt, sorry 0.01 electron volt, not even 1 0.1, 0.01 electron volt to 0.05 electron volt. So that is the kind of distance above the top of the valence band you have this acceptor impurity level. So into that level there is a vacancy actually. So electrons will go there, leaving behind a hole. So electrons can easily do this because it takes only very small energy. And another thing is that there are a lot of electrons on the conduction band due to the thermal generation, and what will happen is that they can fall into this level and get to occupy this free levels. So from conduction band you can now electrons can come to this newly created impurity level, or from the valence band you can go, because it will only take a very small amount of energy. So this is relaxation, and this is like excitation. So excitation from the valence band and relaxation from the conduction band. So what will happen here, the opposite thing is going to happen. N0 is going to reduce. Okay, so let me write it here. So relaxation from conduction band result in reduction of N0, and then excitation from valence band. Okay, I'll just write valence band result in increase of P0. So P0 will increase because in valence band you will have more and more holes. Why? Because of this excitation. Okay, so this is what is going to happen. So there will be lots of holes that is generated in the valence band because of this excitation into the newly created donor level, which is just above the top of the valence band. Usually in the energy gap there is no levels, but when you dope it, it creates some levels like this, which means that there is an unsatisfied bond which is seeking some electrons to come in. And from the valence band it will only take a little amount of energy to reach there. And also from the conduction band electron can come to those newly created levels and then occupy these places. Okay, so there will be electrons occupying these levels which come either from conduction band or valence band. As a result, N0 goes up, P0 goes up. Okay, so this goes up and N0 goes down, reduction of N0 and increase of N0. So that is the physical way we can look at what happens in a p-type semiconductor. Alright, so I'll stop here.